Hello, hello, hello. Oh, no, thank you. Thank you so much, Caleb. Good morning, everybody. Hope you guys are doing well as people are starting to join us online and people are slowly going to be trickling in to Starbucks or not to Starbucks. That is the question that will be going through their mind. It's a good day. It's a holiday season. Officially in the Bible, we have entered the season of autumn. Though today still doesn't quite feel like autumn. It's still a little too summer humid-like for me. But in that time of transition, this is also our second to last Sunday here at the Sumu Center. So we have our final service will be next week. And after we have the service next week here, that will be our last time. So we do have maps in the back to our new location, as well as the Chuseok picnic, and I'll be making this announcement again. I'm just kind of allowing some people to kind of log on and things like that. We will be having our new service October 8th at the new location at 3 p.m. Have some patience with us on the first Sunday and the second Sunday and the third Sunday as we will be inevitably learning new system and getting all together, but it's gonna be exciting. It will be something fresh and something that the Lord has. So I'm really looking forward to that in this time. And then with today being the Feast of Trumpets, I have brought the shofar with us today. So that should be quite exciting. Hopefully that will be good. And I'm just looking forward to what God has to share with us. And I'm really hoping that God has already been speaking and sharing with you guys, especially in those areas that we've been really discipling in the last summer, during the summertime, and that you have an expectation to begin to see something in this coming year. Amen? So let's just go before the Lord in prayer. We just want to come together in unity and purpose with what God has for us. We know that the Lord is with us. We know that this Holy Spirit is with us. We know that He is for us. We know that for those who love Him and have been called by Him, He has written our names in His Lamb's Book of Life. He's inscribed His name upon our heads. We are His people and He is our God. We are His sheep and He is our shepherd. We are His bride and He is our beloved. So Abba, Father, we come before You today with thanksgiving in our hearts, with giving You praise. That Lord, thank You that we can praise You, that we can thank You, that we can worship You. Thank You that no matter the season we're in, no matter if we're on the top of the mountain or the depth of the valley, You are there. And is that there is no God worthy of praise, worship, adoration, honoring, no name worthy to be sung about like Yours. So God, we lay down our burdens and our prayer requests right now to just know that Holy Spirit, You know what we need and You are here to give to us, Your good children, every good and perfect gift. We ask You, Lord, that You would come and inhabit the praises of Your people. Because today is a day You have made, and we will be glad and rejoice in it. Thank You for the seasons and the appointed times, that they remind us of who You are and who we are. You are King above all things, King of kings, Lord of lords, God of gods, none besides You. All things are established in You, through You, and by You. So Lord, come, receive the worship, praise of Your people this morning. As we just say, thank You, Jesus. Thank You. Amen. Let's worship together now.
Empire. Third line in the second verse, that we'll join in singing with all the redeemed. And with that, you know, we're not just talking about, you know, all the churches on Sunday, but, you know, we've all read about the throne room scene so many times, so I'm not going to read that to you now. But, you know, the saints and angels all bow down before God, and John received this revelation from Jesus, and it's like, you know, we are joining our voices to that heavenly worship right now, because that's going on right now, too. And worship is an eternal thing that, you know, even when in Psalm 148, verse 3 to 6, it says, praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, highest heavens, and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded them, and they were created. He set them in position forever and ever, and he gave an order that they will never pass away. So even at the dawn of creation, the stars, the sun and moon worshiped him. And so we're joining our voices to that worship of our God, of Jesus, this morning. So let's continue to praise him as we worship the Prince of Peace.
You are worthy.
Is 11. 11 people. You were close. You 10. Anna was closest for 10. We play a game every Sunday morning when it's time to start. How many people will come in during worship? So I think the correct answer was 11 people came in during worship. So it's good. So glad you guys could be here. As you can see, it's a different kind of Sunday. You know, I don't usually walk around with a ram's horn, blowing a ram's horn around and things like that. But yesterday was the Feast of Trumpets. And depending upon tradition, it is celebrated for 2 days. So it would still be celebrated today in countries outside of Israel. In Israel, they just celebrate it for the 1 day. But outside of Israel, they celebrate it for 2 days. And so we're acknowledging the Lord in that, in the blowing of the trumpet. So I know the kids wanted to practice it before service, but if you guys do want after service, you can come and try and give it a try if you want to give it a try after the service. This one's a little bit more difficult to blow than some really, really good ones. This is a good one, but not a really, really good one. Really, really good ones is like just super simple. Just put up and blow and you can go. So if you're interested in getting a shofar, you probably just need to save around, say, $5,000 and come with us to Israel when we go in about a year. So that's the goal. Just start to save up and then you can pick out your very own shofar when we do try to go in about a year. I don't think we have any announcements before the kids need to leave, correct? All right, so let's get all the kids to come forward for Messy Church. We do have a few of our little ones are sick with COVID today, so we do want to keep them in our things. Let's all get together over here. Good, 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 and many things, but it's really nice to see everyone who's come. So this is the generation that is going to grow mightily in wisdom and favor and the joy of the Lord. So may the Spirit of God be upon you all. May the graciousness of God be upon you all. May the Lord just smile upon you and give you wisdom and grace as you grow in Him. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen? Oh, he's ready, and he's ready, and she's ready, and another one, and David is going to go there today. Woohoo! Very, very good. Okay, and high five in the back. Air five. Boom. There we go. Nice. It's okay. We embrace everybody, the extroverts from Caleb to the introverts who like to stay. It's like we embrace everybody and we need everybody. Amen? Yeah? Because if everybody was Caleb, no one could breathe. And if everyone was in the back of the room, everyone would feel awkward. So we need a mixture of everyone to be able to come. And that's the goodness about God. There are quite a few simple announcements, but we do have announcements to make. First and foremost, like we said, next Sunday will be our last Sunday here. So it's really kind of surreal that after about 7 years in this location, it is time for us to leave and things like that. Now, as many of you guys know, it wasn't our decision to leave. We kind of had no choice. We were given no choice and had to leave. But God has prepared a great place for us, and we're going to be sharing a space with the Heart House Church. It is at Shinsa Station near Exit 1. We do have some physical maps in the back of the room for people who are curious. We have updated our website now to show where the new location also will be, but it's really 2 minutes walk from Shinsa Station Exit 1. And we're going to upload some videos soon that will kind of show the walking path to get there. It's a change in the sense that we will not be starting at 11 a.m. So next Sunday is the last Sunday for 11 a.m. We will have a Chuseok service, Sukkot service, that's going to be very, very short, that's going to be broadcast from a phone on YouTube Live. And that will probably be around anywhere from 11:15-ish. We're going to say ish because we're going to the Hangang River for a church picnic on Sukkot and Chuseok Sunday. Chuseok is for Korean Thanksgiving for people who don't know what Chuseok is. And so there's also maps in the back for how to get there, both driving directions as well as walking directions. And then we're also putting that on the website, and if anyone needs help, you can contact us and we can try to arrange groups to meet depending upon which way you're coming, and then to be able to walk to the river. It's about a 15-minute walk-ish, depending upon where you're walking from, either Shinsa Station or Changwon Station or Okujeon Station, or if you're taking a bus, there's different ways to get to the area that we're going to. In Hangang, so it should be a really nice day, it should be a nice time. If you want to get there early, like me, I will get there early so we can like get a few tables and like the areas where the shade is going to be, so we can have some nice shade. Please bring your blankets, your things to sit on the grass, some lawn chairs if you want lawn chairs, just like when we went to the beach. There are a couple tables, but most likely we're going to make those into the buffet table for food. And so we do have a sign-up sheet in the back, And we're going to ask that, we're just trying to get a head count approximately. So if even if you think you might go but might not go, let us count you as going so that way we get enough food. Because we want to make sure there's plenty of food. Now, we always add to the number because the Jewish heart and Korean heart both, you know, you if there's not enough food, it's a shame. So we're going to make sure that there's more than enough food, but we just want to kind of get a sense of who is coming. You are allowed to bring guests and friends. I think Anya is going to be coming with her mom from South Africa who's visiting. So that should be quite exciting. Bienna and Tony will be back. They're actually coming back in about 10 days. As we know that he left when his father unexpectedly passed away. And so they're going to be coming back and will be joining us there at the park and things like that. So I do want you to know, so if you have colleagues, for those of you who, for example, work in Hagwon or, you know, you work and you have some foreigners who haven't done anything on the weekend and just want to have a good meal and enjoy, this is perfect time to just invite people to come. I think like when GA last year, she had like workers from Europe who were just visiting, and she just brought them, and they just fit in and had a great time, and they weren't even believers, but, you know, they got to just meet and hang out with people. So I just really, this is a good time. So one of the big difference, again, between Korean heart and Jewish heart is Korean heart, when I was here for Chuseok, my first, second, third, fourth, anyway, I shared, nobody invited me at all. I was just like all by myself. I didn't realize like everything was closed down. Now, we know now there are things open, but you know, 15 years ago, everything was still closed during Chuseok, like actually on Chuseok. Now I really enjoy how quiet my neighborhood gets. And some people have already invited me this Chuseok, so I'm really thankful and grateful for that. So so some people are like, oh, can we invite you over? I thought, okay, why not? It'll be nice. And things like that. But again, please feel free to invite. This is a good time. So we will have enough food. Don't you worry. But we're asking that you bring side dishes. So you can bring some kwaja, snacks. You can bring some dessert. You can bring some fruit. But be thoughtful in the sense of it's a picnic in a park in which we're going to be holding plates. So if you're like, oh, I want to bring like a great big salad, you know, sometimes that's difficult to just like pick up. So just think about how you want to bring, but please feel free. So we want to be able to have lots of good stuff and things like that. I think last year, one of the real popular ones was guacamole. And I think it went like in 2 seconds. So if you guys want to make things like that, it's okay. Well, don't worry. We'll eat it. We'll make sure. Pardon me. So there we go. So I think with that, we're moving. We have Chuseok. I think that's pretty much everything that we have at the moment. So, but we will be here next week with that. So, whew, praise God. Hi, guys. Happy New Year. You're like, huh? What? New Year? No, we don't have New Year yet. In biblical times, this holiday was treated differently depending upon which time we're thinking at. So in the actual like Torah, this day is called Yom HaTeruah. So Teruah means literally the day of blowing. And it was a very simple holiday, but it was a holiday that God gave to Israel through Moses. It's found in Leviticus. So when we're looking at Leviticus 23, and God gives all of his feasts and holidays, his moedim, his appointed times, that this is one of those days. Now, because of the expression, the practice, and some things, a lot of people call it the Jewish New Year. Now, there's a lot of reasons why it became called the New Year. It's a little odd because it's actually the seventh month in the biblical calendar. So in the Bible, if you just type in seventh month, you can see all the different things that took place during this time. And there's lots. There's lots of stories that take place. Very important stories take place during this time. The book of Ezra and Nehemiah, the opening up of the Torah scrolls and the reading of God's word for the first time as the captives of Babylon finally came back to the promised land all take place during this time. There's prophecies from the prophet of Haggai that take place during this time. We begin to see even some aspects of Noah and things that happen with Noah take place during this time. And as we begin to move forward and look at this, then of course in the book of John, we see lots of things that take place at this time. So we're going to see a lot of, for example, over the next couple weeks is like John chapter 7, John chapter 8, all take place around this particular time. So this is an important season. And what does this season kind of represent? What does the Feast of Trumpets really represent? Well, first of all, how many of you like the sound of the shofar? Okay. It was like a slow wave, like a few people, like, okay. You know, if we're like, all right, like, oh, that was good. Wow. It takes a while for the lips to warm up. That was the best one I did, so that's cool. So, like, the sound, there's something in the, like, reverberation and this that makes people, like, become attentive and to wake up. And this is a regular shofar. So, like, in the Bible, when it said they took a ram's horn, this is your typical one. So, for example, when Gideon chose his men, and it finally got down to the final 300, and each one had a shofar and a lamp. And they blew the shofar, they blew the trumpet. So if you imagine, and in Israel, remember that just like Korea, Israel is full of mountains. Now, Korea has a lot of granite mountains with like great big like trees and things like that, whereas Israel is full of limestone and not as much vegetation on the mountains. So when big, loud things like this begin to happen, it just reverberated throughout the whole land. It just, the sound carries and carries and carries and carries and goes on. I kind of talked about that a little bit last week. But this is the trumpet. Now, they also had silver trumpets that they made, which were great big long ones, you know, burr, 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 and they had this. And then there's what's also called today like a Yemenite horn, which is like the much larger shofar that has like two curls. And if you get a really big one, it has like three curls and things. And it either comes from an antelope or it comes from the ibex. Now, how many of you know what an ibex are? Oh, just like one, two. Okay, you should look up ibex, I-B-E-X. They can be massive animals. They're natural mountain goats that live in Israel. They are incredibly agile. They can go up a sheer rock cliff that you would think like it's impossible, and you would just see them leap up the mountain. I've watched this happen. And then when two males start to fight, like I was in the area where King David was hiding from King Saul, and it's an oasis in the middle of the desert. Okay, and this place that especially in the cool of the morning and just at sundown that the animals come to drink, right? Like that's the normal time to come and drink. And so you can see these ibex, and it's now a mountain reserve, so all the animals are protected, so they're not really afraid of you. You can even see videos of some kind of like a guest house that's very near this area, and they'll just like walk into the hotel room. And so, and you're thinking, oh, it's just like a mountain goat. Like, oh, little goat. No. Like mountain goat, like a full male, the head is here. It can be like over 1.5 meters. And then when you get the horns are up here. And a full-grown adult male, the horns are massive. And I actually was in a place where there was one of these goats. It was larger than a car. And if it decides to attack a car, it will knock the car upside down. Like, they're that powerful. So when these two males started fighting, it sounded like a car crash constantly as the horns just, like, hit each other and hit each other. So it's incredibly resilient, incredibly strong, incredibly almost stubborn, if you will. Now, remember, God called Israel a stiff-necked people. But then he gave us a stiff-necked animal and a thing as part of our worship. So when we begin to see these areas, when we begin to come to these times, if we think like it's just Jewish holiday, then we can miss some of the spiritual context in which God wants each of us to be able to grow from. Because Israel, as a group of people, are very, very stubborn people. We have an incredible, you know why they call us stiff neck? Do you know this term, stiff neck? Do you know what that means? Okay, so I think like when God was having the contest of which people were going to be his chosen people, he decided, I need to find the most stubborn. And there was a great competition in the world to discover who was going to be the most stubborn. And it finally came down to two finalists, the Korean people and the Jewish people. We're so, so similar. And it finally came to the final test. And it came time to bow before Hananim. And when the Koreans came to bow down, they bowed down like this. But when the Jews came to bow down, they went like this. Kind of like Kyopo, you know? Like, oh, 안녕하세요. So it's, hi, I'm Kyopo. You know, like this. And so God's like, oh, stiff-necked people win. So the difference was Korean people managed to get their head down, but the Jews were like, nope, not going to do it. And so here we got this goat in this area that was going to become this symbol. Now, if you just take the horn, now this is the thing. Remember, in the Bible, in Torah, you cannot just kill an animal for its horn. It's not allowed. If you kill the animal, it must be completely used. You have to use the meat. You have to use the hide. There has to be a purpose. It cannot just be for an economic gain. That is a mismanagement of the resources of God. And so, and within these horns, so they have to actually wait for the animal to die before they harvest the horn. Now, in the antelope side, they actually shed their horns and grow new horns. But with the ram side, I believe they just keep growing and growing and growing. But if you just take it, it's a great big circle. And even this, if you just take it, you can't do anything with it. It's just a dead animal, you know, byproduct. But only after it dies and you get the horn, then they have to heat up the horn. They have to make it soft. And they have to drill the horn. They have to actually drill out the center to be able to make space for the air and the wind to be able to blow through for it to be a sound. But still, it's not ready. And then it has to be heated up again, and then it has to be cooled, and then it has to be heated up. And if you heat it too quickly, it will become brittle and it will break. If you heat it too slowly, you'll never be able to mold it. But through the proper amount of heat, through the proper amount of fire, then it's able to be twisted. And after it's finally able to be twisted, then it gets to relax in a nice cool bath in order for it to become even stronger, to hold its shape and to be ready. But then, even then, if you blow it by itself, it's still going to smell like death. It needs to be cleaned. Because this is just dead, but it needs to be cleaned. Now, if you just take this by itself, right? You're like, okay, it went through the fire and it got twisted and it got shaved and it got drilled and then it got rested. And then you're like, okay, it's ready. And you're like, make a good sound. There's no good sound. Why isn't it making sound? Unless it is filled with the breath, with the ruach, with the spirit. It cannot make a sound. It cannot make a pleasing sound. It cannot make these things. And so this is the very picture of our own lives. We all start out as a dead hunk of meat. And by the grace of God, we come into his presence and we have revelation of his son and we accept who he is. And then we're like, yes, but there needs to be a fire of God, a refinement of God. There has to be a season that makes us uncomfortable so we will change. We have to begin to realize that there's something more. We weren't intended to remain a dead hunk of meat, but that God wants us to be used in a greater and a deeper way. So we have to go through the fire, but not too intensely. Some people just love the fire, like all in. I want to go all in. Like, Lord, let your glory fall. Let your fire fall. Oh, let the fire fall. Refiner's fire every day. Every day it's fire, fire, fire. We need the fire. I got to be in the fire. I got to be in the fire. And if you're like that, if you're the person who wants to always be in the heat and in the fire, you will become brittle and break very easily. Meanwhile, if you're a person who's like, I just want to stay in the river, let me stay in the river, let me dance in the river, you will become waterlogged, you will become soggy, and you'll become useless. You need to go through the fullness of God, and that's what the seasons have been about from the time of Passover, and we shared about each and every single one of the appointed times of God, that if we go through the discipleship, if we go through these things, and even through this long summer, we're going through seasons of warfare, of difficulty, of good times, of relaxing, of refreshment, of encouragement. We have exactly, and if you leave yourself in the hand of the Lord, it might be uncomfortable as you're being twisted. Ow, 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 ow. Oh, ooh. But that's not where we're supposed to stay. Because even after this process, you need to be filled. You need to be filled with God. You need to be filled with the presence of God. You need to be filled with the Word of God. You need to be filled with the Spirit of God. You need to be filled with the anointing of God. You need to be filled with the glory of God. You need to be filled with who He is, because otherwise you're going to still just be a dead block on the shelf. And when you start to blow, I had pictures of my brother-in-law trying to do this a couple days ago at my mom's house, and he was because he played the trumpet, so he thought he could play this easily, but and his face was getting so red. But there's a way for the sound of God to come. But when it first comes, and if you come up and smell, let me tell you, not the hyungi of the Lord. It is not the fragrance of God. It smells bad. But you know what? That just that you need to get the air flowing. You need the bad to come out. You need that old man to die. You need, like, sometimes you're like, oh, praise the Lord, listen to that sound. And then you're like, ooh, what was that? You're like, oh yeah, sorry, that was a little bit of the old person who came out this week. It's interesting, one of the best ways to actually clean this is with things like soju. So if you fill it with a clear spirit, a clean spirit, it kills the bacteria. Now, some people like to put anointing oil, like fragrant anointing oil inside, and let me just tell you, that's nasty and disgusting. You think, oh, it smells so good, but you know what? It leaves such a foul taste, and then it really doesn't get rid of the smell. You're just trying to cover up the smell. And even in that is a spiritual lesson during the season, because there are people who just want to cover up their bad smell with a good scent, but they still smell bad. But God wants us to be cleaned out. He wants us to be filled with His Spirit so we can make the right sound at the right time. And during this holiday for the Jewish people, they go through all the different sounds that were used in the temple and for the usage of the people at all different times. Everything for, it's time to be called to attention. It's time to be gathered. There's an announcement coming. Listen up. Listen up, everybody. Come on. Something's important about to happen. And then there's like this an alarm sound. There's an alarm like, oh no, the enemy is coming. The enemy is coming. The enemy is coming. Who's going to sound the trumpet? Who's going to sound the alarm? Who's going to be the watchman on the wall? Who's the one who's looking out? And if you're the one who's like crying wolf, I think almost all the like internet, YouTube conspiracy theory channels are all crying wolf all the time, so no one will listen. Who's really going to be looking for the real enemy? Where is the real enemy today? Where is the real thing coming against the community, coming against yourself? And who is sounding the alarm? And when the alarm sounds, is it like, have you become dull because so many alarms have been sounding? False alarm, false alarm, false alarm, false alarm. Do you guys ever have like fire drills? Do you know what fire drills are? You know, in buildings and just kind of being in like resident halls and group living situations, there always has to be a fire alarm. And YWAM, every YWAM base has to have fire alarms, for example. And I don't know why they decide to do a fire alarm at like, you know, 11 o'clock at night. And so it's like, oh, there goes the alarm, and all right, and then everybody slowly gets out because they all know it's just a test. It's only a test. But have you ever been in a real fire? Anybody actually been in a real fire where a fire alarm went off? Oh. Did you know there was a fire? Or did you think it was an alarm? Huh?
There was a cracking sound.
There was a cracking sound. I was in a place actually, and the smoke was in the hallway. And I was like, this is not a drill. Get out of your rooms now. Get out. And finally, people started running because then they opened their door and could smell that something was on fire in one of the rooms. And you don't know, is the whole place about to go up? But there's a spiritual thing about that alarm. Is the alarm sounding? But then there was also a call for calling the people for worship, a call for prayer, a call for intercession, a group calling, like, oh, there's the sound, we're coming. And every time that the Bible talks about, then there was a solemn assembly, a time of repentance, a time of acknowledgement of, like, the community sin or the corporate sin or the corporate gathering before the Lord. There was a sound that was played so that the people, and it sounded like an animal dying. And you can, you know, like. And even in that sound of like this animal dying, it began to tell the people, now's the time to really, are you opening up the heart and not hiding behind shame, not hiding behind guilt, but just standing knowing, Lord, before you we are guilty. And before you we want to change. And then there was a call that announced the coming of the King. The King is coming, the King is coming, the King is coming. And if somebody of importance, if someone of status was coming, you cannot be caught unaware. He might not have announced his coming, but if the watchmen are looking, they can see if the enemy is coming, but they can also see, is the King of honor, the King of glory coming? Is it a season in which you must be ready, you must be prepared? And this holiday right now is a season of getting ready. It's that practice. It's that, are you paying attention? It's the fire drill of the Spirit. And this in this holiday itself, you know, the time of being awake is because this is the start of the end times. So Jesus said, like, this is going to be a season that the coming of the Son of Man is going to be like a thief who comes at night. And there was an idiom that said that the Feast of Trumpets would come like a thief at night. Because they had to wait until night to see, is today the holiday or not the holiday? It's all based upon if there's no moon tonight. And you needed two witnesses to go out and verify that there was no moon. If there's no moon, they would come back and tell the high priest, two witnesses agree, tonight is the night that the start of the holiday. And then they would blow the shofar, and they would blow the shofar, and it would go throughout all the land. They said that no man would know the day or the hour of the coming of the feast. And it says, likewise, no man will know the day or the hour of the coming of the Son of Man, of the Son of God, the return of Jesus. No man will know the day or the hour of his return. But we basically know the season. He gave us all kinds of things about knowing the season. Look to the fig tree. When you see the fig tree blossom, you know that summer is near. So too will you know that the season is near, because, and that's the end of the summer season in Israel is just after the fig harvest. So we know that there's that end is coming, but not exactly yet. There's still more things that need to happen, but are you awake? Do you realize what will happen? Because it's also the beginning of the ingathering. And the season of the ingathering is that final harvest, right? We're almost ready for the harvest moon. When's the harvest moon? In 2 weeks. At the next full moon is the harvest moon. This begins Chuseok. So last month there was a super moon, and then this month at the full moon as the beginning of Chuseok, but that's also the season of Sukkot, the Feast of Tabernacles, the end gathering. So this is literally like, this is the time that you've been waiting all summer. And the grapes are coming in, the dates are finally ready, the pomegranates are finally ready, all of the things that have been growing all summer long are finally ready. You already have your grain, all of your grain is done. That's the beginning, that's the first fruits. We celebrated that at Passover, and we celebrated that at Pentecost. But this is the end gathering, this is when finally everything is going to be done. And this is why in an agrarian society, an agriculture society, that it is the Feast of Tabernacles when your tithes, your offerings, and your vows were due to the Lord. Because finally all your harvest is done. You've done your harvest. You've taken things to the marketplace. So if you're close to Jerusalem, you bring the actual harvest. If you're far away from Jerusalem, you would sell your harvest and you would bring money. This is where the beginning of giving tithes and offerings in cash actually began, was that as Israel spread out and as society spread out and they went more from not just agriculture, but they also went into commerce and these things, it's the first time that money became the sign of the tithes and offerings. In ancient Israel, literally, you would bring the firstborn of your flocks to come to the temple. You would bring your actual hides. You would bring, you know, your fruits. You would bring the grain. You would bring the grapes, or even the dried, the raisins, or the figs, or the dried figs, or the fresh dates, or the dried dates, or the pomegranates. You would bring these things into the temple, the olives and the crushed olives. This is all that season right now. It's a busy season. It's time to work. It might have been hot in the summer. It might have been slow in the summer and you're just watching things grow. But now is the time. This is the season that Jesus said, the harvest is ready. It's time to go and it's time to harvest. Because what will you bring into the storehouse of the Lord? And in the practical, do you guys know about the storehouses of the Lord? Have you heard this term, the storehouse of the Lord, the storehouse? That there were supposed to be cities that were set up throughout Israel that would have storehouses to the Lord. You're like, oh, what's this? Literally, it was a place just like, remember with Joseph way back when he was sold into slave into Egypt? And he had that dream, 7 years of plenty, followed by 7 years of famine. And he got Pharaoh to start storing up. And he took the tithe of the land, and then he took like 20% of the land and all these goods. And then when the famine came, began to sell it back to the people. Well, God said, I want a storehouse. And you're thinking, well, of course, the Lord deserves a storehouse. But what was the point of all that grain? What was the point of all that dried fruit and all those dried things? What was the point? And it was literally that in the day of famine, in the day of trial, in the day of trouble, that the people of God would be able to come to the house of the Lord, and the Lord would then be able to feed his own people. That was one of the points. That was one of the purposes of the temple. It wasn't just for the priests to be able to get fat on the offerings of the people. It was actually supposed to be a storehouse of the Lord so that when the people go through war and all of their fields are burnt down and they no longer have seed for their crop, they could go back to the storehouse of the Lord and the Lord would provide back for them the very thing that they need. And this is a reciprocation. But there's going to be a day, and there's going to be a time in which the King of Glory returns to this earth with the sounding of the blast of the shofar. There's a lot of repeating over the next 3 weeks because of the way the holidays go. So today is still the Feast of Trumpets. And then next Sunday evening and Monday is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. And I'm going to talk about the Day of Atonement next week. At the very end of the Day of Atonement, when it's fully done, it's the most solemn day on the biblical calendar, is the Day of Atonement. It's the one day a year the high priest is allowed to go into the Holy of Holies. Can you imagine? Now, I know in Korea, it's very common for kids to go into mom and dad's room, but in Western culture, mom and dad's room is like the holy place, and like mom's bathroom is like the Holy of Holies. You know, no kid is allowed to go into mom's bathroom because it's the cleanest bathroom in the house. It's like, you're going to dirty the bathroom, dirty another bathroom. But if this is the clean bathroom, it's the holy of holies. Like, do not go into the holy of holies. And then if you were like, you know, your older brother is in the bathroom and like you really, really have to go, you have to get special permission from mom to be able to go into the Holy of Holies. And this is the same way with God. It was like only one day a year did he give special permission for the high priest to come into his intimate chamber to have communion, relationship with him. That actually would be Monday morning for us, is when that actually takes place. So at the end of all of that, after the end of all of those things, there's a final blast of the shofar. It's called Tekiya Gedulah, the great and mighty blast of the trumpet. And on the Jubilee, they would blow, they were supposed to blow that shofar. They were supposed to blow that blast in which not only would all the slaves be free, not only would all debt be canceled, but also all of your inheritance, which has been lost over the last 50 years, is supposed to be restored. And Israel never did it. They never honored the Jubilee. Now, many people want to know, like, when will a Jubilee happen, and is there a Jubilee? There's no way. So when you hear, is this a Jubilee in Israel? You know, they're making some assumption based on some calendar. Nobody knows when the next Jubilee is, period. Nobody knows the day or the hour. Nobody. Because only God knows the actual time frame, because it's too lost in time and history, that it began at a particular point when Israel entered the promised land, began the counting of the 50 years, and we don't know what that is because our calendars have all been changed. But I truly believe that Jesus will come with that final blast of the trumpet, just like he said he will. And there will be a great fulfillment. And so between this day, the Feast of Trumpets, and Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, in these 10 days, the Jewish people, now this is just a tradition, it is not biblical, and I don't believe this in the sense of this year, but they believe this is the only time that the books of life and death are opened and closed. This is it. It started last night, or Friday night, it started Friday night, and it concludes Monday evening. And at Monday evening, God will close the book of life and close the book of death, and either you've been written in the book of life for this year or the book of death, and it is what it is. So this is the week right now in Israel you can talk about sin. It's the only week that Jewish people will listen to about sin. Because every other day, they're like, the book of life and death, it's already closed. Whether I sin, I don't sin, it's already done. God already knows. But during this 10 days, they're doing everything they can to try to get into that book of life. Except acknowledge Yeshua as their Messiah. Poor people, they love this time. All the beggars, this is their favorite time of year to be a beggar. Because they just go into a shop, and they have coins in their hand, and they just shake. Ching, 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 and they say, tzedakah, tzedakah. Tzedakah means like charity or righteous act. Like tzedakah, tzedakah, tzedakah. And every shopkeeper, every person will put some money in their hand because they want to be written in the book of life. It's like, here, come on, come on. And so right now it's like everybody, this is so like every homeless person, poor person, like they're going, hey, you, can I have some money? And so they, yes, they can go. So you have to like avoid them. Right? Like, I've got money, but I got to avoid the poor people. I've got to avoid the homeless people, you know, and because God forbid someone comes and asks you and you don't have it. Maybe that, you know what, that great spiritual karma is going to come and God's going to be like, ooh, this was the deciding one. So sorry. Dies. But that's not our God. That's not our King. But we do know that there's a book of life in heaven. And we do know that for all who are saved, and as you get saved, your name's inscribed in that book. And there will be a time, Paul calls it, when the fullness of the Gentiles comes. And then Israel's great awakening comes. And when the gospel has been preached in every language and tongue, when it's gone throughout the entire world. So there's two things about the end times that must be fulfilled for Jesus to return. One, the gospel must go to every tribe, tongue, language, and people. All of them. And just as an interesting side note, I just saw a statistic yesterday or the day before that said that from Wycliffe, the Bible translating, they're the main Bible translating mission in the world. They've been doing this. But now with in connection with all of the major mission movements and church movements of the world, we're all cooperating right now, including YWAM. Everybody's cooperating to get the gospel into every language. And that last year, I should say this, previously on average, every year about 100 new projects begin in translating the Bible into another language. About 100. Last year, over 400 new languages began. 400. I just got a message today from Togo, one of my good brothers in Togo, and he's said that he's praying right now for a motor scooter, a motorbike, so he can begin to go and evangelize, but they're also trying to get into all the different villages where they know there's different languages to actually assess how many languages don't have the gospel right now. Who doesn't have the gospel in their own language right now? So that way this next year, when they do their oral Bible translation school, they can begin in those languages. They can find somebody who knows that language and at least one other language that the Bible is translated into, so they can bring the gospel even orally into these oral cultures, because a lot of those cultures don't have a written language. And so it's an amazing project, and I'm going to be able to be part of that next year. I'm going to be able to go to that school. It is something that God is leading up to. If anyone wants to go to Africa with me, it'll be probably about 2 weeks' journey. It will be very hot, uncomfortable. The water is fantastic, however. The base water, and remember, we actually paid and gave them a big, big, huge offering to be able to finish their water tanks so that the entire base has water all the time. Their well water has been certified clean enough to be sold as bottled water. And so they actually came. So that's the one plus side, so you don't have to worry about bad water. It's really great water. You may have to still, you know, shower with a bucket, but, you know, hey, go to Jim Jabong, you still do it then with a bucket too. It's okay. But can you imagine that the gospel is going now to every tribe, every language on earth? We are so close. And that's one of the requirements for the return of Jesus. But the second requirement, Jesus said to Jerusalem, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I long to gather you like a mother hen would gather her chicks. But you will not see me again, Jerusalem, until you say, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." That there was these two requirements that need to happen. And there has been revival growing within Israel. There's been a revival growing within the Jewish people. Some say that there are more Jews alive today that believe and confess Jesus as Messiah than any other time in history, including the first century. But we're still just about 1% of the Jewish people. And I believe God wants more of Israel to recognize Yeshua. So there's two things that are coming. And we're getting closer, and we're getting closer. As I shared last week, that there were Jews, indigenous Jews, who were born in the land of Israel, who are believers, more than one generation, two generations, three generations, believers in Yeshua, our Savior Jesus, and that they have taken the word of the Lord and from Israel became missionaries to the nations again. Not since the days of essentially by 160 AD, when the second Jewish revolt happened and Rome was so angry, they just kicked all the Jews out. They're like, get out. It was the great dispersion of the Jewish people. Get out, get out. And they forced the Jews to go around the world. But in the last 130 years, God has now been bringing Israel back to the promised land. God's been fulfilling his promises. The desert has been blooming like a rose. The valley of dry bones has begun to rise up, and slowly the flesh has come upon them. And they're still standing there in the great prophecy of Ezekiel with the valley of an army, but they're not alive yet. And God said to Ezekiel, prophesy and say to the wind. And he said to the wind of the north, the south, and the east, and the west, the place where the Ruach, the Spirit of God, went, The Holy Spirit, each place that the gospel has gone, the north, the south, the east, and the west, that the nations, that the casting off of Israel has been salvation for the nations, that the nations who were lost, now accepting Jesus, believing in Jesus, have come back. And now because there's a stirring in the nations who have received the Spirit of life, they're prophesying back to Israel, you must live. And God said to Ezekiel the prophet, now prophesy that these bodies, these bones will live. And the Spirit of God came and entered this great mighty army. And we're just at the beginnings of that. We're seeing, and I'm seeing in my own people being transformed bit by bit, slowly by slowly. And it says that when Israel begins to confess Jesus as Lord again, it will be life from death to the nations. So as Israel gets saved, there's more revival in the nations. As there's more revival in the nations, more of Israel gets saved. It's a synergy. It's a thing that happens that we need each other because we're called to be one new man. One bride, one body. There's not supposed to be Jew and Gentile. We're supposed to come together, but we each must come and do the fullness that God has asked us. And this is the holiday that asks you, are we full? Are you full? Are you doing the work of the kingdom? Do you have the fruit in your life that is going to be eternal? What are you going to bring before the Lord on that final blast of the trumpet? What are you going to bring to God? No one comes to the king empty-handed. But it's also not to be compared. This is why he said that the master gave one talent to one servant and five talents to one servant and 10 talents to another servant. And they come, and then when he comes back, he wants to see, what did you multiply? If you have been given much, much will be required. If you've been given little, then you know what? Even in your little, you still must multiply. The little is your salvation and your grace. Have you multiplied the grace that God has given to you just once? It isn't good enough to say, I am saved and now I hide. It isn't good enough to say, I'm saved, now I go into my prayer closet. And I just wait for the return of Jesus. What will you bring with you? Because you know what? God is not impressed by job titles. God's not impressed with bank accounts. God's not impressed with looks. God's not impressed with abilities. But it's what you do with the title. It's what you do with the bank account. It's what you do with your gifts and your talents and your abilities. It's whatever you do with it. Have you added to the kingdom of God? Have you used the fullness of who you are? If you have a talent and then you've just dropped it and not doing anything with it, then how are you adding to the kingdom of God? For he has given you a gift for something. Many people, when they get saved, especially if your gift was being used in a worldly way. So if you were using your looks, for example, to seduce people and to live a promiscuous life, or if you were using your wealth in a greedy way, or you were stealing, or you were, you know, I know people who are part of the mafia, for example. Or people who were really, you know, were in business and were out, you know, doing room salong and drinking and drinking in the negative sense. And then they got saved and then they gave up all of their talent. No, you have the duty to the Lord to use your giftings for him. If you have a gift in an area, you have a duty to multiply it for the kingdom of God. Because when you bring it to the Lord, you're going to say, I used this voice in this way. I used my influence in this way. I used my wealth in this way. I used my talent in this way. I used my gifts in this way. And this is how I've multiplied. And the Lord then will say, well done. Well done. This is not about getting into the kingdom. Getting into the kingdom is by grace and grace alone. And if you do nothing else, that is enough. The man who died on the cross, who said, this is the Son of God. This man has done nothing. And Jesus said, today you will be in paradise with me. That man never repented. That man never got to use his gifts for the Lord. He got the grace and salvation of God, as in the kingdom of the Lord. Better is one day in the courts, in the gates of the king, than 1,000 days in the tents of the enemy. That's what David said. And it is enough to be in the kingdom of God. But those of us who are already in the kingdom of God, are you awake? Are you awake? Are you awake? The king is coming. The day is coming. The ingathering is coming. There's going to be a real king of a real kingdom. And are you going to come with your gifts and your offerings? Are you going to come with your talents? And are you going to come with the resources and the harvest of God? Are you coming? Are you coming? Are you coming? And some people are like, yes, this is what I've been living my life for. And some people are like, oh. And that's why this is practice. That's why this is an alarm. How many of you use an alarm to wake up in the morning? Where are my alarm people? Okay. And how many of you have to use multiple alarms to wake up in the morning? Oh, Anna, proudly. That's nice. Okay, how many people use multiple alarms? You're like, okay. That's why God gave us the life cycle. Multiple alarms. Some people need it. Me personally, I remember as a kid, probably from about middle school, I hated waking up to the sound of the alarm. If the alarm went off, I would wake with a start, and I hated that. I didn't like the feeling of like, oh, I've overslept or something. And so I trained myself to wake up 5 minutes before my alarm goes off so I could turn it off before it went off. That's just what I did. I'm one of those people. However, sometimes my body rebels. And then I don't wake up. And I think, well, okay, body can rebel from time to time. If it needs the sleep, it needs the sleep. But God wants us to get that way in the spirit, that eventually we don't need the sound of the trumpet to remind us that the day of his return is near. But if you do need it, you're not supposed to take shame and guilt. You're supposed to simply repent, which means stop. Yes, turn back in his direction. Yes, I am now focused on the things of God. That's what this time is about, to wake up. Are we waking up? What are we bringing at the time of the end gathering? What are we bringing into the storehouse of the Lord? And ultimately, some people will ask, always get this, do I really need to care about the Jewish holidays? No, of course not. You don't need to care about Jewish holidays. There's Israel Independence Day and Memorial Day and Holocaust Remembrance Day. These are Jewish holidays. But the Feast of the Lord, these were things that were of God that were given to Israel to teach the world about Jesus. Because he said to Moses, these are my appointed days. Does that mean you need to observe it like Israel? No. You don't need to become Jews. It can be fun. You can learn a lot, but you don't have to observe it that way. I do. Why? I'm a Jew. David does. David's a Jew. You can learn from it. It's no problem. But you don't have to copy Israel. But we need to know the principles of God of the season, and we need to be awake. So the psalm that is read during this holiday is Psalm 47. And we're going to look at Psalm 47 together. Who is this holiday for? Clap your hands, all peoples. Okay, that's a command. Clap your hands, all you people. Yes. This is not clap your hands, all Israel. This clap your hands, all the nations, all the peoples of the earth. Clap your hands. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. Sounds good so far. For the Lord, Yud Hey Vav Hey, the name of God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the living God of Israel, he who was and is to come, the everlasting God. The Most High is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. Who is the king over the earth? Who is the king over all the earth? Jesus, Yeshua. Not a trick question. I know, I have a bad reputation. Everyone's like a little afraid. It's not a trick question today. At least I don't think so. For the Lord Most High is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. He subdued peoples under us and nations under our feet. He chose our heritage for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loves. Whenever you see Selah, okay, some people name their children Selah. It just means a musical rest, a breath. It's a note. So if you're like calling your child Selah, literally what you're doing is, hey, come here. That's Selah. Selah is take a breath. Pause. Okay. God has gone up with a shout. The Lord with the sound of a... Sing praises to God, sing praises to our King, sing praises, for God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with the psalm. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the peoples gather as the people of the God of Abraham, for the shields of the earth belong to God. He is highly exalted. This is a psalm of the one new man. The people of the earth with the remnant of the people of Jacob, God's pride, that we come together to the throne of God. We all must come to the throne of God. We all must come underneath him. This is what the Lord has encouraged us. So who is your king? Who really is your king? Who is the king of your life? Who is the one you are bowed down to? Who is the one you have humbled your heart to? Who is the one that you cannot live without? Who is the one that you are preparing for? Who is the one that you're giving your time, your gifts, your resources, your finances? Who is the one that you would be willing to dedicate your child to the purposes and will of? Who? In Korea, they would say, yes, God. But in reality, they say, oh, no. We dedicate our children to the God of education and wealth and money and status. We'll go to church, but we dedicate our children to these other things, and then they wonder, why is the nation lost? Who are you submitting your life to? Who are you submitting your will to? And if it is Jesus, what does this king have to say to us? What does this king have to say to us? Many people wait until January 1st, the Gregorian calendar, to wait and hear on the Lord. I want to hear from the Lord. God, what do you want for us? But if this is the season of his return, if this is the season he's going to be enthroned, if this is the season of the great judgment, if this is the season of the great harvest, if this is the season of finally all the nations coming and submitting to the truth of the king, what does he say this next year is going to have for us? So one of the things as I was seeking the Lord over the last few days and asking God, God, what do you have to say for us? What is it that you want us to be preparing for? And I was seeking on this. I felt like the Lord strongly said that this is next year is the season of making sure you have the sure foundation. What is the foundation of your life? What is the chief cornerstone in your life? Do you have a solid foundation? And that he wants us to not just secure the foundation, he wants our foundation to grow so our lives can grow. You can only grow as big as your foundation. A house needs a very shallow foundation. Lotte World Tower needs a foundation that goes so deep into the earth so that thing doesn't fall and people are still worried about it. What is your life being called to, whether little or great? What is your life being called to? So I'm going to start focusing on that. We're going to start with the foundational books of Scripture. We're going to go through all five books of the Bible next year, Genesis to Deuteronomy. There's a Bible study that will come out every Wednesday that will focus on Jesus in the Torah, Jesus in the first five books, every Wednesday. And on Sundays, I'm going to be focusing on showing the fullness of God in Torah, meaning God the Father, Holy Spirit, and Son, the fullness of God as being revealed in these first five books. Because if we know that, you know that the rest of Scripture is built upon those books, all of it. And we want to have a big foundation because God has been speaking words to us in our move, that our next move is not just so we would grow spiritually, but that we're also going to grow physically. And if we're going to grow physically, we need to have some changes. We need to have some small groups. We need people to rise up who will say, I want to care as well. I'm a big guy, but you know what? The church can't rest upon me. I'm a jiggly foundation. We need the solid rock foundation of Jesus. So this next year, we're going to see that. We're going to grow as a people in the Bible, in the Scriptures, in the principles. We're going to encourage one another, and we're going to really grow in things because this is going to be a safe place. People are not going to be afraid to confess their sin to one another so they can be saved. I really believe that it's going to be a time in which sin addictions are going to be broken, that fears are going to be broken, that mindsets are going to be broken, that there's going to be an encouragement, an outpouring of God, that the gifts of the Spirit are going to be alive. We believe in it and we know it and we see it, but are we going to exercise it? God is going to give us classes and step by step, and I believe this, that we're going to see that fullness of Scripture in some way come and be revealed to each of us. That we're coming in, not just, we're, you know, like, We need to change. We physically are changing. We've purged a bunch of stuff. We cleaned up a bunch of stuff. We only have one more week here. We've gotten rid of a lot of things. We're going into a new place and a new home. And it's just a temporary home, but it's like going into the presence of the Lord. So God, depending upon our foundation and the faithfulness and how we grow as a people, will determine our next stop, our next place. Will we get our own space? What will God do? How will God use us? What will God say for our community? How will we grow? How will we encourage? How will we be set free? No shame, no guilt, the love of Jesus, the grace of God, the power of the Holy Spirit. A humbling, so we'll be a people of humility. So when God moves and God does, God will get the glory. So as we begin to move into this last song of worship, let's worship. Let's worship. I don't want to give a lot for this coming week because we shared so much, but I want you to prepare your heart. I want you to know what you are preparing to bring to the King. Next week is the Day of Atonement. And typically the Bible says you are to afflict your soul. It doesn't tell you how to afflict your soul. It just says you need to afflict your soul. And the way that they collectively did that was by fasting. I'm going to give you a week and a challenge, something we haven't done communally, but I am going to call and ask that from next Sunday evening, in the biblical understanding of fasting, it's sundown to sundown. It's not midnight to midnight. It's sundown to sundown. And if you are able to fast, we're going to ask for a fast on Monday. One, because we want to be awake as a community. We want to be receptive to God. We want to just set apart just a little brief part of what's going on in us as we are about to move into a new location. If you have been praying for the salvation of someone, it's the perfect time. Let their name be written in the Lamb's Book of Life before it's too late. I don't need to fast for my salvation. I know I'm already saved, but you know, when I fast on Yom Kippur, it's for my people who don't know who God is. That the scales would fall from their eyes. And if there's someone like that in your life, we want to be standing for that. So just prepare yourself. And if you're like, oh, I can't fast, you know what? Maybe just go to Juke for the day. You're like, oh, give up coffee and give up the snacks and the good things. Maybe just have a plain juke if you need to eat. It's okay. There's no shame. There's no guilt. If you can only give up one, if you've not fasted a whole day and you can just give up one meal, great. If you can do two, wonderful. If you have a health condition, do not take any shame or guilt. If you have a health condition, if you're pregnant, if these things, like, you don't have to worry about that. It's not to be a burden. It's to be a joy and part of worship. You know, oh, Jesus, I'm doing this for you. Oh, pickle paw for you, Jesus, pickle paw. No. If all you can give up is social media or entertainment for the day, then give that up. But in some way, just prepared. From next Sunday, Sunday evening, we're going to call for a fast. And I just want you guys to kind of be prepared for that. But for now, as I blow the shofar, I want us to be ready to sing and just worship. Listen to the words again of the song. And let's worship the Lord.
Yeah.
Where has he been good in your life? Chuseok, the end gathering, Thanksgiving, is a season of giving thanks for what the Lord has grown in your life. Just think about that now, and whether you say it out loud or say it from your heart, but begin in your mind and in your mouth and in your spirit, begin to say how the Lord is good. Shine through us this week. Show us, Lord God, what we have to bring into your storehouse. Show us the areas we need to continue to work. But give us hope that you are the King of glory, the Lord of all. You are the one who's going to come again, and we're going to be your people for all time. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, may you guys have an amazing week. May you know that the Lord is with you and how much he loves you. That may you truly experience the blessing of God, the coming into relationship with the Lord. Blessed be the Lord God who loves you and keeps you. The Lord whose face shines upon you and is gracious to you. The Lord who lifts up his countenance, brings you into his hospitality. The Lord who looks upon you and smiles. And may the Lord give you the shalom of shalom, the peace above all peace. that you would be a people of blessing, for the Lord has blessed you.
Yivarech Adonai ve'yishmorecha Yoveru Adonai panav lecha v'chunecha Yisal Adonai panav lecha ve'yasem lecha Shalom.
In the name of Jesus, our Messiah, who's the Prince of Peace, be blessed. May you have an amazing week and be a blessing as you are indeed a blessing. Amen.